What do you do with an author whose works you love but whose politics you hate? Or authors who have deep insight and great sensitivity in their artistic productions, but they appear to be quite unpleasant, even reprehensible in their personal lives? How do we think about Heidegger's remarkable narration of the history of Western philosophy or the place of humans in the world alongside his anti-Semitism and his sympathy with the Nazis? It seems that Charles Dickens led one of the first public shaming campaigns against his estranged wife. Norman Mailer stabbed his wife. Jack London wrote racist essays. And then there's Woody Allen and Roman Polanski, accused of sexual abuse of minors. And then there's Peter Handke, whom the New York Times once called the Bob Dylan of genocide apologists. The year was 1966, and the group of 1947, the Gruppe 47, you know about them, they had organized one of their last meetings, and they would in fact dissolve the following year in 1967. They were meeting this year in Princeton in the United States, and they had invited a young author to take part in the meeting and to read from his works. That young author was Peter Handke. At the time, he was 23 years old, and he was very much a newcomer to the literary scene. No one quite knew what to expect from him. The group of 1947 was filled with established writers, well-known writers, well-respected writers. Günter Grass had just finished the Danzig trilogy, and he was living in Berlin. Heinrich Böll was starting to emerge as one of Germany's most important public intellectuals. Nelly Sachs was about to receive the Nobel Prize, and the Beatles were about to release Revolver. Handke had been sitting quietly, listening to the others, but when he got up to speak, a storm broke loose. He called the group's literature ridiculous. Their language was barren, he said, and the form of their literature was conventional. Such stupid literature might just as well be copied out of an encyclopedia, he said. And literary criticism praised this pathetic literature because it was equally pathetic. This was how Handke entered the literary world. He matched his outrageous debut at the group of 47 with the play Publikum's Beschimpfung, which means offending the audience. It premiered later that year.
Sie alle sind willkommen.
Dieses Stück. Deine Vorrede. Sie werden hier nichts hören, was Sie nicht schon gehört haben. Sie werden hier nichts sehen, was Sie nicht schon gesehen haben.
Sie werden hier nichts von dem sehen, was Sie hier immer gesehen haben. Und Sie werden auch nichts von dem hören, was Sie hier schon immer gehört haben. Sie alle werden hören, was Sie sonst gesehen hätten. Und Sie alle werden sehen, was Sie sonst gehört hätten.
Sie werden kein Schauspiel sehen. Ihre Schaulust wird nicht befriedigt werden.
Sie werden kein Spiel sehen.
Oh, ihr Herzkranken, oh, ihr Lebergeschwellten, oh, ihr Wassersüchtigen, oh, ihr Schlagflussanfälligen, oh, ihr Todesursachenträger, oh, ihr Selbstmordkandidaten, oh, ihr potenziellen Friedenstoten, oh, ihr potenziellen Kriegstoten, oh, ihr potenziellen Unfallstoten, oh, ihr potenziellen Toten.
Handke immediately became well known as a wild new voice, the enfant terrible of modern German literature, somebody who was prepared to break all taboos. Some even called him the pop star of German literature. Handke was born in Carinthia in Austria in 1942. Austria had been occupied by the Nazis since 1938. His father, his biological father, was one of the occupying soldiers, and his mother did not marry his father, but married another occupying soldier, Handke's stepfather. And his mother was a member of the large Slovenian population of southern Austria. The province where he was born was right on the border with Slovenia. Remember this for later. Handke grew up in relative poverty, and he already knew in high school that he wanted to make a living writing literature. That's what he wanted to do with his life. He studied law in the Austrian city of Graz from 1961 to 1965, and he chose law because he believed that that would earn him a living while giving him enough free time to be a writer, just like Franz Kafka had done before him. But Handke broke off his studies before they were complete, and he devoted himself exclusively to his writing. He developed wide-ranging interests during his time in Graz, and many of these would have important impacts on his writing. For example, he loved rock and roll, he loved the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, and he loved jukeboxes. In 1990, he wrote a piece called Essay on the Jukebox. Handke had a special interest in popular culture. He loved football, cartoons, James Bond, cars. He loved the American landscape. He loved road movies. He loved road trips. And he went to the movies almost every single day while he was a student. And so it made sense that sooner or later he was going to try his own hand at movies. In 1966, Handke met the film director Wim Wenders after a performance of Offending the Audience. They began working together and they made the short film Drei amerikanische LPs, three American LPs. Something about this film which is very Handke, the American landscape, the desolate, neo-capitalist, almost post-industrialist American landscape with its strange fascination, the rock and roll, the theme of the road trip, the automobiles. These would all stick with Wenders and Handke. And it was the beginning of a long and very productive relationship. The film that we're going to be watching is a co-production or co-written by Handke and Wenders. It's quite different from these interests I've been talking about, but it's different in ways that still bear Handke's characteristic mark. The outsider wondering how they can relate to the inside. The internal narrative, which maybe has a relationship to reality and maybe doesn't. In the year after the three American LPs, 1970, Handke wrote one of his literary masterpieces, Die Angst des Tormanns beim Elfmeter, The Goalie's Fear at the Penalty Kick. It tells the story of an ex-goalie in soccer who's suffering from some form of psychosis. He murders a young woman and he sets out on a kind of a road trip, a sort of a road trip by foot and bus, wandering from place to place, kind of aimlessly, not really fleeing from the law, but at the same time being pursued by the law. And in the course of the novel, they gradually close in on him, and it looks like they're about to apprehend him, but the novel closes before they do. It leaves us with open-ended questions. Wenders filmed the story in 1972, and in that same year Handke published Wunschloses Unglück, something like Misfortune Without Desire, or Undesired Misfortune. He was reacting to the suicide of his mother, who had taken her own life after battling depression for many years. In 1978, he wrote the screenplay and directed Die linkshändige Frau, The Left-Handed Woman, which was a novel, another one of Handke's masterpieces, which he had published in 1976. And this book tells the story of Marianne. She's been married for 10 years, living in Paris. She has a son, and she decides one day she doesn't want to be married anymore. We don't quite know why. But she leaves Paris, moves to the countryside, and what started out as a quest for freedom starts looking more and more like loneliness and alienation. And like the previous novel, like the Goalie's Fear, it doesn't really seem to be going anywhere or making any definitive statements. It's a set of questions, very subtly and gently asked questions for us, the readers. You may be getting the idea. Handke is interested in examining the lives of individuals who are pursuing a life outside of the social norms that have been given to them. He's not really interested in pursuing the successes or the failures of their actions. He's more interested in examining their inner state, their inner minds, how they deal with their identities living outside of society. And in this, he is a master. You should read these novels. The film that Handke made of The Left-Handed Woman was very successful. The French newspaper Le Monde called it a magnificent, successful film. By the time he wrote The Left-Handed Woman, he had published 20 more volumes of plays, poetry, novels, short stories, essays. In 1986, in collaboration with Wim Wenders, as I mentioned, he made Der Himmel über Berlin, Wings of Desire. Two angels observe the world. They see the world, they can hear the inner thoughts of the people going about their everyday lives, just like Handke the writer can hear the inner thoughts of his protagonists. But the angels cannot intervene. They can watch, but not intervene. One angel, Damiel, who's played by the actor Bruno Ganz, the great German actor Bruno Ganz, decides that he wants to become mortal. He wants to interact with humans, even at the price of losing his immortality. The film returns again and again to Handke's poem Song of Childhood, which he wrote especially for the film.
Als das Kind Kind war, ging es mit hängenden Armen, wollte der Bach sei ein Fluss, der Fluss sei ein Strom und diese Pfütze das Meer. Als das Kind Kind war, wusste es nicht, dass es Kind war. Alles war ihm beseelt und alle Seelen waren eins. Als das Kind Kind war, hatte es von nichts eine Meinung, hatte keine Gewohnheit, saß oft im Schneidersitz, lief aus dem Stand, hatte einen Wirbel im Haar und machte kein Gesicht beim Fotografieren.
Nine years later, in 1995, what was left of Yugoslavia was at war, a brutal and terrible war which shook Europe to the core. and Handke decided to travel through Serbia. He later wrote, "It was above all on account of the war that I wanted to go to Serbia, to the land of what were generally called the aggressors, but I was also drawn to the country to look at the one I was least familiar with in Yugoslavia, the one that, due to the reports and opinions, had exerted the strongest attraction, and together with the alienating hearsay, was, so to speak, the most interesting." In the following year, he published a travelogue of his journey. It was called Winter Travels to the Rivers Danube, Save, Morava, and Drina, or Justice for Serbia. This was shocking. Serbia was not the so-called aggressor, it was the aggressor. Handke went back to Bosnia that same year, and he traveled to Srebrenica, where in July 1995, Serbian-Bosnian soldiers had murdered more than 8,000 men. He met with Radovan Karadzic, who had been indicted at the International Criminal Court for war crimes, and this was due to his role in the Srebrenica massacre. This was shocking. In his travelogues, he criticizes the media coverage of the war, and he speaks of sites of alleged massacres and of alleged genocide. Later, in 2006, Handke will jump to the defense of Slobodan Milosevic. He visited Milosevic in prison in The Hague, where he was to appear before the UN Tribunal on War Crimes, accused of genocide and crimes against humanity. And when Milosevic died before he could be tried, Handke gave a eulogy at his funeral. This is shocking. In 1999 already, Salman Rushdie had nominated Handke as runner-up for International Moron of the Year. The winner, in Salman's opinion, was the gun lobbyist Charlton Heston. 20 years later, the Nobel Committee awarded the prize to Handke. The writer Jonathan Little wrote, "He might be a fantastic artist, but as a human being, he is my enemy. He's an asshole." Hari Kunzru wrote, "Handke is a fine writer who combines great insight with shocking ethical blindness." Slavoj Žižek observed, "In 1914, Handke called for the Nobel Prize to be abolished, saying it was a false canonization of literature. The fact that he got it now proves he was right." Handke is turning 80 this year. He lives in France, and he's published over 80 books, and he holds numerous literary awards.